That is the Indian Point Nuclear Power Plant. It's just 30 miles north of New York City, which is one reason people have been fighting over this plant for decades.
More than 2,000 anti-nuclear protesters gathered at the Indian Point power plant.
We're in the danger zone, and we better demonstrate today.
New York's Indian Point nuclear power plant threatened with shutdown for lack of an approved evacuation plan.
If we ever had a major problem at Indian Point, that might be a problem that we couldn't solve.
In early 2021, after years of protest, Indian Point finally shut down.
We're celebrating the long-fought closure of the Indian Point nuclear power plant.
Indian Point will close in 4 years, 14 years ahead of schedule.
This is the power of the bully pulpit, the power of organizing.
Here's the problem. Up until then, the vast majority of the electricity used in New York City that didn't come from fossil fuels came from Indian Point. What happened here is an example of the complicated role that nuclear energy is playing in the fight against climate change. Nuclear plants generate about 10% of the electricity that we use around the world, but 20% in the US, and 52% of the electricity in the US that's not from fossil fuels. Experts widely agree that in order to slow climate change, we need to use fewer carbon-emitting fossil fuels. But the number of working nuclear reactors in the U.S. has been declining.
Each one that shuts down, you know, it's like a half a gig to a gigawatt of mostly carbon-free energy gone from the grid.
That's longtime energy reporter David Roberts.
If you shut the nuclear plant down today, most likely you're going to get a bunch of natural gas to replace it.
Take these three nuclear plants shut down in three different states. Here's where these states got electricity before the shutdowns and after. More fossil fuels in every case. So far, that's what's happened at Indian Point too. In this case, nuclear was replaced with natural gas.
And so then you have natural gas's local pollution problems, which are substantial, and then there's climate change.
But of course, when it comes to nuclear energy, people have some concerns.
This is Batu.
Is Batu coming with us?
He's my crew.
Yeah.
I've come to see Indian Point for myself with John Lipscomb and Richard Webster, who are part of an environmental group that was instrumental in the agreement to close the plant.
20 million people live within 50 miles of this plant. You can't afford an accident here.
People think about Chernobyl. People think about Three Mile Island. People think about the sort of famous nuclear meltdowns.
With Indian Point, people are worried about a meltdown with a specific cause.
Al-Qaeda actually considered targeting a nuclear power plant.
It became clear to many of us that this was a safety hazard.
You put some C4 in and you blow them up.
See, you're doing it, Bobby. You're scaring the hell out of it.
People still argue about what actually would have happened in the event of an attack, but the fear of an attack was an important factor turning public opinion against Indian Point. The thing is, the tragedies of nuclear disasters create a skewed picture of how dangerous nuclear energy actually is. All energy sources come with some degree of danger. One common way to measure that danger is to compare the number of deaths a type of energy has caused, like through accidents or premature deaths from pollution, with how much energy it provides. What we'd call renewables, solar, wind, water power, these are extremely safe by this measure. Natural gas is less safe. Oil and coal are much, much more dangerous. Here's nuclear. This takes into account all nuclear accidents, including thousands of deaths from radiation.
So if you're choosing between nuclear and fossil fuels, purely on a safety basis, there's no comparison.
What's so interesting is that everybody I spoke to agrees on these facts. They just interpret them differently. To David, the numbers show how rare a nuclear disaster is. To John and Richard, the numbers are beside the point.
That measure of normally occurring deaths from various industries is a very valid study. But you can't have a nuclear meltdown in a solar farm. So there's the normal nominal casualties that the industry develops, and then there's this nasty possibility that hangs out there.
But human safety wasn't the only concern that led to the plant's closing. When operating, Indian Point needed to take in 3 Olympic swimming pools worth of Hudson River water to cool its reactors. The water went in through these grates and then was filtered through a grill, then flowed on into the rest of the plant. It was supposed to keep fish and other organisms from getting in and getting killed, but often it didn't.
And there are organisms that are either pushed onto the grill or they're entrained on the water, go through the plant and get killed. And we estimated about 1 billion organisms a year were being killed in that way.
The ecosystem can't bear that kind of assault. We think the river has its own rights.
In addition to the harm that the cooling system did to wildlife, in 2015, a fire at the facility leaked thousands of gallons of oil into the Hudson River. And in 2017, a deal was struck to shut down the plant. But many argue shutting down plants like these is short-sighted.
The people who have those concerns are sincere and those concerns are real. But in all human affairs, you have to ask, compared to what? Climate change, if unrestrained, that is going to be far more devastating for far more ecosystems and far more rivers and bodies of water than any conceivable effect of, you know, a nuclear power plant.
Richard would say that's a false choice.
I don't think it's a choice of emit carbon or kill fish. It's like, those are not the choices we have. We have a third choice and we should use it.
Long term, he might be right, but not in the short term. We just don't have enough renewables yet.
Even if you replace that gigawatt of lost power with renewables, that's a gigawatt of renewables that isn't going to replace fossil fuel plants, right? It just moves your baseline back. Right now, we just have lots and lots and lots of fossil fuel power plants on the grid, so we don't have the time or luxury to sort of optimize here. Like, let's keep what we've got is my take.
And then there's the third big factor at play here, which is the reason these nuclear plants are so vulnerable to public opinion in the first place. In the last 10 years, the price of electricity from renewables and natural gas has plummeted as their production has gotten cheaper and easier. The price of electricity from nuclear has gone up, in part because of regulation to address safety concerns. Existing nuclear plants are struggling to compete, and building new plants has become prohibitively expensive. So when you combine cost, plus the fear of a disaster, plus the environmental threats, it's not hard to understand why nuclear plants are closing. But David says there's one final distinction here that should be getting more attention. Something that nuclear energy has that renewables don't yet.
Wind and solar energy come and go with the weather. So you need something that, you need power that's firm. And by firm just means you can turn it on when you want to and run it as long as you want to. We have tons of firm power now. I mean, most of the power on the grid right now is firm. Every fossil fuel power plant counts as firm power. But what you need if you're going to decarbonize is clean, firm power, i.e. firm power that doesn't emit greenhouse gases. That's much trickier. There are not as many candidates for that.
Nuclear is not the only option for clean, firm power, but it is one that we have right now, one that's currently putting huge amounts of power onto the electricity grid. What happened here at Indian Point shows that fighting climate change is going to involve a lot of hard choices. On either side, there are people that value those choices differently. On the one hand, environmentalists, and on the other, as David likes to call them, climate hawks.
A climate hawk is someone who places a high priority on the threat of climate change and supports aggressive means of tackling it, trying to solve it.
In the long term, though, they want the same thing, an energy future that harms the planet less.